In the enzyme catalyzed reactions tutorial, we talked about the thermodynamics and kinetics of chemical processes. We saw that Gibbs-free energy, or G, tells us about the stability of the starting materials and the products. The change in free energy, delta G, is used to determine the spontaneity of a reaction, whether the reaction would, if possible, proceed in a given direction. We contrasted this with kinetics, which tells us about the rate of a reaction. The activation energy is the energy barrier that must be overcome if a reaction is to proceed, and it determines the rate of reaction. Activation energy is used to determine how likely and how quickly that process can happen under given conditions. And we saw that enzymes can lower activation energy by binding and distorting molecules, bringing them together in just the right orientation so that the reaction occurs. In this tutorial, we'll look at adenosine triphosphate, ATP, the cell's energy currency. We'll apply these principles of thermodynamics and kinetics to ATP, and we'll see how ATP can be used to drive other non-spontaneous reactions. Here's the structure of ATP. Notice that adenosine is a ribose sugar covalently bonded to adenine, a nitrogenous base. Adenosine is used not only in RNA, but also as a form of energy storage when covalently bonded to three phosphate groups. Each phosphate group has multiple negatively charged oxygen atoms. As we saw in the DNA and RNA tutorial, these negative charges exist because of electron transfer between hydrogen and oxygen, forming O- and H+. The hydrogen ions dissociated into the watery environment of the cell. Just like magnets, like charges repel each other. As a result, phosphate groups that are covalently bonded together store potential energy. It's as if you took the repelling ends of two magnets and tied them together with a string. Because your string is strong, the magnets don't fly apart. But if you were to cut the string, that potential energy would turn into kinetic energy, and the magnets would move away from each other. The covalent bond between phosphate groups is like the string. It's strong enough that the phosphate groups stay together, but if it were broken, the phosphate groups would separate and energy would be released. Not only does breaking this bond separate those repulsive negative charges, it also increases entropy. While the phosphate group and the rest of ATP must be in the same place if they're bonded together, once that bond is broken, the phosphate group can be randomly located near or far from adenosine diphosphate, or ADP. Additionally, water molecules with their partially positive hydrogen atoms now have better access to the negatively charged oxygen atoms of both phosphate and ADP. All of these things create a large driving force to break apart ATP. Here's the reaction. ATP is broken into ADP and a phosphate group, called inorganic phosphate, or Pi. This is a hydrolysis reaction, where a molecule of water breaks the bond between the phosphate groups. The hydrogen ion that is made dissociates into the cell and is sometimes attached to ADP or inorganic phosphate, so often it is not written in the equation. Energy is released when ATP is broken, which means that the reaction is spontaneous in this direction and delta G is negative. ADP and inorganic phosphate have lower free energy than do ATP and water, and that's because ATP is storing potential energy by bringing those phosphate groups close together. Remember that Gibbs-free energy tells us about the energy of a molecule that can be used to do work. Our cells use the energy of ATP hydrolysis, breaking ATP into ADP and inorganic phosphate, in order to drive many non-spontaneous processes. The energy released by breaking off a phosphate group can be immediately harnessed for other purposes. This is through coupling reactions, which requires the help of an enzyme. In the enzyme catalyzed reactions tutorial, we looked at the first step of glycolysis, the phosphorylation of glucose. We saw that overall this process is favorable because G6P and ADP have lower free energy than do glucose and ATP. There are really two reactions happening simultaneously in this step, breaking ATP into ADP and inorganic phosphate, and joining glucose and inorganic phosphate to form glucose-6-phosphate. We know that the delta G of this top reaction is negative and the reaction is favorable. The delta G of adding a phosphate group to glucose is positive, and this reaction is unfavorable. phosphate wouldn't naturally form a covalent bond with glucose. These molecules are more stable separated than they are joined. This is a non-spontaneous reaction, and it requires energy input. That energy comes from ATP hydrolysis. As an analogy for coupled reactions, imagine this scenario. You're standing on a trampoline. Your friend is standing on a deck above that trampoline. Your friend has gravitational potential energy. If she jumps, she would naturally fall toward the trampoline. As she falls, her potential energy is converted into kinetic energy. Once she hits the trampoline, some of that kinetic energy is transferred to the trampoline, which changes conformation. The movement of the trampoline is then transferred to you, who gain kinetic energy, as well as gravitational potential energy, as you fly into the air. Your friend is ATP, which loses potential energy as it's hydrolyzed into ADP and inorganic phosphate. Much of that energy is transferred to hexokinase, the enzyme which is the trampoline. As hexokinase undergoes a conformational change, it provides the energy to drive the phosphorylation of glucose, which in this analogy is you flying into the air, a non-spontaneous process. Conveniently, we can find the free energy of a coupled reaction by adding the free energies of the component reactions. For the first step of glycolysis, the hydrolysis of ATP is more spontaneous than the phosphorylation of glucose is non-spontaneous. In other words, the delta G of the overall reaction is still very negative. Under normal cell conditions, the coupled reaction is spontaneous and virtually irreversible. ATP is used in a similar way to drive many cell processes. The potential energy stored in the bonds between phosphates is harnessed to do work. But if the hydrolysis of ATP is so favorable, why doesn't ATP break apart on its own in cells? Remember that how easily or quickly a reaction takes place has more to do with its activation energy than with delta G. The activation energy of ATP hydrolysis is high enough that ATP does not hydrolyze without the help of an enzyme. This is what allows us to use ATP as energy storage. With all these ways to use ATP, there must be some way to regenerate it. This is the purpose of cell metabolism. Regeneration of ATP is the reverse of hydrolysis. It's forming a covalent bond between ADP and inorganic phosphate to result in ATP. Remember that the delta G of a reverse reaction has the same magnitude but the opposite sign as the delta G of a forward reaction. To form ATP, not only must any energy barrier be overcome, but enough energy is required to store potential energy in the bond between phosphates. This reverse process, the synthesis of ATP, is also achieved through coupled reactions, using the food we eat as the energy source. The covalent bonds between molecules of food store energy. Cellular metabolism is the process in which those bonds are broken, releasing energy that can be harnessed to form ATP.